really glad that we're finally getting around to doing this.
Yeah, me too.
This laundry definitely needed to be folded, and I was really shirking my responsibility. And yet, I found at the end of the day that it's better to not be a shirker and to be a doer of things.
Isn't that the name of a movie?
You know what? Now that you mention it, I think it is a movie. I think it's a documentary. Hello and welcome to In the Fold. I'm Sarah.
And I'm Amelia.
And today we're going to be reviewing the movie Shirkers.
When I was 18, the thing I wanted more than anything was to make a movie. I had the idea that you found freedom by building worlds inside your head. That you had to go backwards in order to go forwards.
How'd you see Shirkers? How'd you hear about it?
I heard about it around 6 a.m. on a Thursday in Park City, Utah, when I was at Sundance. My friend was hell-bent on seeing movies by women. That was her whole, she had been to Sundance a few times. I went to Sundance this year.
Which is funny because I also went to Sundance this year. We just found this out.
Yes. I was there for personal benefit and health. I don't know. Well, you were there for press.
Yeah. Yeah, I was there for press. Mm-hmm. I worked for a podcast called Pure Nonfiction. You should check it out. So I got to do like all these press screenings, which was really cool. They're just showing all of the movies for press and they could go in and see it. It wasn't, there weren't Q&As for it, but they were just scattered throughout the time that I was there. So I got to see tons of documentaries. But Shirkers was one that I knew that I wanted to see the Q&A for. I wanted to like be in a theater and see that and experience this movie with other people because the hype around it was unbelievable already.
I love that you had hype. I didn't. Like I showed up at 8:30 a.m. on a Thursday and my friend's like, all right, we're seeing Shirkers. I was like, what is this?
Thank your friend though then. That's a good friend move.
We talk about this all the time. She's like, aren't you so glad that I dragged your ass out of bed at 8:30? And I was like, yes.
My friends and I shot a road movie on the streets of Singapore called Shirkers.
In 1992, Sandi Tan was a young teen living in Singapore, and she wanted to make a film, a movie, with two of her really close friends and a very Svengali mentor, made a feature film in Singapore. It was actually one of the first indie films made in Singapore. And Shirkers is the story about that film, the journey of how the life of the film started and where it is today, because it's a mystery.
I chose George as my new best friend. A man of unplaceable age and origin. After shooting wrapped, he took everything. George was gone, and so was Shirkers.
Right, it is a mystery, and I mean, it's crazy because it would have been actually the first, like one of the groundbreaking films for Singaporean film history, and yet we find out this documentary came around because this movie actually never got made. It's a movie about a movie never getting made, so it's a movie getting made about a movie that never got made, which is really, really entertaining. The person they trusted, their mentor that shot the film with them, that, you know, Sandy wrote and then her friends produced. Completely sabotaged them. They left for college and he was like, I'm gonna stay behind in Singapore and edit it, we'll get it out, and then they never hear from him again. Or he's very evasive. Then 25 years later, you know, or 20 years later, they get a call from his widow because he passed away, and then you find out that he still has all these perfectly preserved 35 millimeter film of their film, which is really a testament to that he kept this film that preserved, because that's hard to do. That takes a lot of care. Sandy's original script for the movie was, she was like the lead role. Her character was S. She was a heroine in it, and she would go around Singapore and find people, yeah, and kill them. She would collect people. She was like a collector of people and like their oddities, and she found a lady with the largest dog and all of this, you know, all these crazy people in Singapore, all these crazy characters, and then she would kill them. It was very cinematic, very beautiful. And it's funny, you know, because Shirkers the documentary is actually very similar except for the whole killing thing, because she, again, Sandy is now herself and she's the heroine and she goes around the world and collect people to retell this story. You know, she's just collecting people and creating this space constantly and having people, you know, come back into this orbit to collaborate and make something out of it.
Our passion and our earnestness came through. Sophie was the producer. Jasmine was the editor. George was the director.
Shirkers, the original Shirkers now, is so much more than just a movie that never was made. It's actually a time capsule for them that is just this beautiful thing that became unearthed again, that they can relive these beautiful moments that will never, never be the same.
There's moments in films that came after Shirkers' time in the independent market that were reminiscent almost of like what she was doing organically.
Part of her could never really let go because she's watching these other films and she's like, you can see the shot by shot comparison now that she's actually found them, but there's just so much creativity that's just so strikingly similar. And you're like, wow, this woman had a vision when she was 17 and she could put this into words and on script and make a movie that these people took, you know, 10 years then to make and re-put it out in Hollywood. And it's crazy. And it just goes to show you that you don't need to go to film school to make a movie. If you have that will and that creative prowess to really buckle down and write something and produce it, then you got it. That's half of what film school is.
Yeah. It's almost like...
And I wish I told myself that 4 years, 6 years ago, because I would be not in debt.
And also, I don't think I was really an asshole. You just have to do things. If you want to make art, you want to, you know, you want to go there and make things happen. You're not going to wait for the perfect condition. You're not going to wait next year. If it looks perfect, if it looks like you can do it now, you have to grab everybody and just make a run for it.
Sandi Tan is a film critic, a writer, and a filmmaker. And she was born and raised in Singapore.
She's hella punk.
She's really fucking cool.
She's fucking cool. She's fucking asshole sometimes, she's but in a good way. Too. Sandy, I see you. Good person.
Sandy, I also see you, but through this camera. Anyway, she and her best friend Jasmine loved film. They loved anything that was punk, anything that was not like a traditional media that they were getting. They created their own zines as teens.
A lot of collages. Which gave way to her style, I would say, for this documentary, because this documentary is just a hubbub of collages.
Yeah, like you can't even specify, it was hard to put into words, I guess, like the style of this film, because it almost is like a zine come to life. It's just beautiful landscapes of a world that I was not aware of Singapore, like at this time. I mean, I don't know much about Singapore myself, and the people that she knew, like all of the actors in the film are friends or people that she and her collaborators just found, and it's just, there's something very organic about it.
Absolutely. All right, let's talk about George.
George Cardona is a very mysterious man.
George had this perverse need to create mythology.
Give us the material so we can finish the film. How could it have disappeared?
He is a film teacher. And there is no film, there's no film schools, there's no film community. He's just this man that has a camera and is like, oh, I know a lot about film. There are other films that are inspired by me, James Spader and Sex, Lies, and Videotape.
Yeah, he's a storyteller. Yeah, so not only is he a professor, but now he has the perfect audience to tell stories to.
So he has these young women who are, and there's some guys, but they don't talk about them. But he has these young women that are just so excited and eager, and they start building a relationship that becomes not, it doesn't skew into anything too creepy, it's just maybe a little intense.
It's intense. I mean, the problem with George, he's a great anti-hero because he's mysterious. Mm-hmm. He is really articulate. You just see him as this guy who wants to help out. Well, you know, he's a good friend, which is something that, you know, really drew this group together because they never met an adult that they could talk to like this because they come from, you know, a generally really different family landscape. The problem that we find out is that
he takes the dreams of these young people and just says, oh, they're mine.
Yes.
What he was he was a very good cinematographer, and he would have been, you know, he could have had a real career if he hadn't, you know, made his thing. He's a very creative guy. I mean, the way he creates is by taking away, and that I find fascinating. I mean, he's a man who kind of lives out the novel of his life by creating absences in other people's lives.
You know, is it really about this old man taking it from these young women, or is it really just about respect? Like, it's this guy who obviously doesn't respect himself enough to be so open with people, because you find out it's not even his real age. His wife doesn't even know some of the stuff he's been doing. Like, he ditches his wife and his kid to go out and hang out with three teenage girls and drive around for the whole night instead of, you know, being home with his family.
What makes this film really special to me, it does have to do with how I saw it. Because, I mean, we both saw it at festivals, we both saw it at Sundance. Not at the same time. That would have been cool.
That would have been cool.
I then saw it later twice at the Montclair Film Festival. And Sandi, who she displays herself in this film, is who she is. I was trying to get, okay, I'll say this for you. I was trying to get her to come to film form, right? I was like, oh, like, hey, like, I love your film. I saw it at Sundance. I have a very nice email template, right? And I sent that to her email, which is just shirkers@gmail.com. So that's how you reach out to her. And she immediately responds and is like, oh, wow, that would be great. I would love to come out and talk. And I'm going to be at the Montclair Film Festival. And I was like, that's great. Let's try to make it happen. Film form is a course, and that is like a scheduled day. She didn't get that because I did not explain it properly. So when it came to film form, like it came to when the Montclair Film Festival was going to be there, I broached the subject again, and she was like, I'm really busy. Like, my schedule, like, I'm doing this, and I don't, like, aren't you, like, you know, isn't this, like, your town and your territory? Like, and I was like, wait one second. And I realized that she had offered to, like, meet students because she's a great person, right? She had, like, wanted to talk to students, but she didn't realize what I was at. Like, I was asking a different thing. I want to make it better one day. Because one of my friends at the Q&A, like, stood up, and because she was like, oh, this is a microphone, this is a microphone. She's like, oh, we, you know, I'm always looking for new young people to work with. And my friend was like, can I do it? And she was like, yeah. And I was like, oh my God, that's so cool.
Ballsy. By definition, shirkers means a person who evades work, responsibility, you know, duty, all of that. And what we really see when we watch both shirkers, there is no difference between these two, is people who do the exact opposite, you know? These are people that are like, they make zines when they're 17 out of collages because they want to be punk and do shit. And then they're also kids that are like, let's make a movie. Let's do it. Like, let's do it whatever cost is necessary. And now, you know, 30 years later, they're like, all right, let's revisit it. I'm going to find out what's going on here and get to the bottom of it. And it's just, you know, you have these anti-shirkers, and really what they're doing is just going after that one shirker the whole time, which is George.
I like knowing that we're connected, that we're partners in crime.
Shirkers became a secret history that would haunt us and bond us forever.
Would you recommend it?
Absolutely. I would absolutely. I have recommended this. If you're my Facebook friend and have been in the last few months, I was telling everybody to go see this movie. A lot of my friends did, and they thanked me for it. They should thank Sandi. She's our god. But Sarah, would you recommend Shirkers?
I would wholeheartedly. I recommend it to really anybody. I think it's a film for all ages, for the most part. And it's, you know, cinematically, it's really well done. It's put together. There's a storyline. There's a hero and an anti-hero. And you really get to see from beginning to end what is a movie and what takes you, what is a movie, why are movies around, what does it do for people. It's a really beautiful thing.
It's inspiring, especially as a filmmaker, to know that against all odds, like, you just have to believe in yourself and your vision.
What?
Go see this movie. It's going to be available on Netflix. 10 out of 10. Wow, I don't really fold laundry anymore. I just kind of roll it up into a ball and hope that my cat doesn't knock it on the floor.
I love a nice floral blouse. Oh, a Montclair State University shirt. Wow.
It's all here. It's all here. It's all beer.
Sandi, forgive me. Okay.
Hi, Mike here from Rabbit Hole TV, here with our mascot pumpkin. Thanks for watching In the Fold. If you like what you saw, please subscribe for more. And if you really like what you saw, you can check out our Patreon where you can see behind the scenes photos and videos. Right, Pumpkin? She says, subscribe.